nominations for late person of the year, and they are needed by next Sunday. The late person of the year, whoever it is, will be announced the following week, November 1st, which is All Saints Sunday. Please pray about who should be considered for this recognition and send a brief letter of nomination to Pastor Tom, Susie Hirschberger, or any member of the lay leadership team. The adult Sunday school class is meeting every Sunday in the fellowship hall at 10 o'clock. We're using books that we had from last spring. Next Sunday's lesson will be the March 29th lesson, which is the people of Judah exile. If you want more information, you can go to our website. Next week, Pastor Tom is taking a well-deserved week off. He and his wife will be visiting family and sightseeing in the Shenandoah National Forest. Teresa will be in the office Monday and Tuesday. Next week, or next Sunday, October 25th, is Lady Sunday. And please pray for all those who will be participating in the service in Pastor Collins' absence. And then, this coming Wednesday the 28th. At 6:30 p.m. and the lay leadership committee will meet to select the lay person of the year from your nominations. Grant and Joe would like to thank everyone for their thoughts and prayers, their cards and calls. They'll be having a graveside service, I think, this afternoon. And when it's safe to do so, there are plans to hold a get-together to celebrate Judah's life, and everyone will be invited. Also, sits enthroned upon the cherub. Let the earth quake.
For the Lord our God is holy.
The Lord is great in Zion. He is exalted over all the peoples.
For the Lord our God is holy.
Let them praise your great and awesome name. Holy is he.
For the Lord our God is holy.
Extol the Lord our God and worship at his holy mountain.
For the Lord our God is holy.
And now let us sing our opening hymn, number 61, Come Thou Almighty King, verses 1, 2, and 4, found in the book.
Thank you.
what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us, then, what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus was aware of their malice and said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And now I'd like to call on the team pastor for the children's message. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
To get started today, I have some questions about sports teams. Have you ever been on a sports team? Have you been able to cheer for your favorite sports team? Here are some of those teams that we've been on or cheered for. You know, maybe baseball or basketball or soccer or football, maybe golf. Do those teams that we just mentioned have any certain colors or names or mascots or uniforms that will help us to know who's on the field? Can you or I buy a jersey or a hat with the same colors and names to show our support for these teams? So if I'm a fan of one team and I'm wearing their colors and jerseys, does that also mean that I'm also supposed to cheer against the teams that play against us? What do we say? Boo! Boo! Yeah, I'm supposed to boo them, right? But what if the people on the other team are nice people? It doesn't matter. They're just on the wrong team. I say I have learned so much from you that thank you. I want us to all think about cheering for different teams because that will help us to understand what's going on in today's scripture. Today's story starts with the religious leaders of Jesus' time and place asking Jesus a trick question. The question they asked Jesus was whether the Israelites should or should not pay taxes to Caesar, the ruler of Rome, who has control of Israel. Now that's a trick question because it would force Jesus to pick a team. Was Jesus cheering for Rome, or was Jesus cheering for the Israelites? Whether he said yes or no, people would have been upset with him. Depending on his answer, Romans or Israelites would have booed him. But don't worry, Jesus was not fooled by this trick question. In fact, Jesus gave a really smart answer to their question. The answer Jesus gave was, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar, give to God what is God's." At first, we might think that this was a word answer to the question. But Jesus' answer was to remind the Pharisees of a story that they knew very well that says that all of us are made in the image of God. In other words, Jesus was telling the Pharisees that the image that they wear is the team that they are on. And the image that we all wear is the same image of God. Even though we're made in the image of God, that does not always mean that we remember or act like we're on the same team. For example, the Pharisees were the religious leaders who tried to stop Jesus from doing what he was doing. They did so because they forgot kept inviting them and everyone else, including me and you and our church, and the whole world to follow him and learn from him what it looked like to belong to God's team. And as we learn from Jesus what it means to be on God's team, we learn how to share with others the same love, forgiveness, and healing that Jesus offers to those around him. And the more we do these same things as Jesus did, the more we help others know that they belong on God's team too. And that's the good news for today. Let us pray. And as we pray, I will please repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
Who reminds us that each of us belong to you. To show us how. To share your love with others. We thank you.
We thank you.
Thank you, Jim. That's a great children's message. I like that. Let us pray. Gracious God, grant us insight and enlightenment as we have a spirit of receptivity of your word. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. My sermon this morning is not about politics. It's not about supporting a specific political party. It's not about it. It is about God. Do you hear me? So please do not interpret the sermon the way you want to interpret it. The local restaurant was so proud of having the strongest cook in the town. So the owner said that anyone who is stronger than our cook, we're going to give you $1,000. The cook holds the lemon and he squeezes down so hard and the juice coming out. After that, anyone who can take that lemon and squeeze just one more drop of juice out of the lemon, he or she would be the winner. So lots of people tried and nobody could do that. But one day, this crummy little man came in and he was wearing a thick glasses and a polyester suit, and he said in a tiny, squeaky voice, "I'd like to try." Everybody was laughing at him, but the cook said, "Okay, try." So he took it and squeezed out all the juice out of it and gave it to the man. And he pushed his hands and then amazingly, three drops of lemon just came out. And the people were very, very cautious about him. And the man asked him, says, "What do you do for a living? Are you a lumberjacker or a weightlifter? Or what do you do for a living?" And the dumb man replied, "I work for the IRS." We know the employees of IRS are very rigid, and extremely persistent. And I was told, do not talk back with them. Whatever they ask me to pay, you will pay. We cannot escape two things. One is death, the other one is tax. In today's scripture, the Pharisees, with the spirit of cowardice and with the incompatible group, the Herodians, sent his disciples to Jesus, entrapping him by asking a question. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperors or not? They put Jesus in a quandary. If Jesus said it was unlawful to pay tax, they would promptly report him to the Roman government authorities as a rebellious person, and his arrest would certainly follow. If he said it is lawful to pay tax, he would be regarded as a traitor of Jews. Jesus' predicament about paying taxes to the emperor or not cannot be easily escaped. Back then and now, the issues of tax and loyalty are very sensitive. They are one of the differences between the Democrats and the Republicans. As citizens of America, we have an obligation to the state to obey its laws and to pay taxes. Scripture confirms these obligations. Paul, in his letter to Romans, he said, God has appointed higher authorities, and we are obligated to obey them. He continued to say, for this reason, we also pay taxes. For those in authority are servants of God's service. Give, therefore, to everyone what you owe, and tax to whom taxes are due, and honor to whom honor. John Calvin ruled that obedience to civil law and the payment of taxes in no way diminish a person's service to God. The exception, of course, is a situation where human law conflicts with God's will, in which case we are to obey God rather than the people in government authorities. So Jesus said, give therefore to the emperor the things that are emperor's. Whatever we are taxed, we paid. When we paid, our duty is done and we are good. And they will not squeeze us anymore. They will not call us. And then, what does it mean? Give to God the things of God. We are made and created in the Eikon, which means image, likeness of God. We bear God's image, and so it is appropriate to give ourselves back to God, all that we have and all that we are, because we are an integral part of God's realm. We are children of God, and we belong to God. Because of our belongship, God claims all we have, our body, our hearts, our soul, our possessions. We are His, and He's our God. When we call Jesus, or God, my Lord, who are we? When children go to school, they call teachers teacher, which implies that they are student. Jim Kaiser called Julie honey. That means you are Jim, you are her husband. When you call me pastor, and you are my parishioners. So when you call Jesus, God is my Lord, what does it mean for us? It means we are slave or servant of God. To be a servant in the Bible requires individual obedience to his master. In other words, whatever the master commands us to do, we do. And whatever the master wants us to be, we go. The servant does not choose his own daily job, but does whatever the master asks him to do. To be a servant has a limit, one's own possessions. The servant owns only what his master gives. More importantly, if I'm a servant today, I will be servant tomorrow until I die. Not only me, but my wife will be a servant as well. Not only my wife, my children and grandchildren, all my offspring will be servant of the same master. Unless the master give me the freedom. So it is my responsibility to teach all my household to be a faithful servant. In doing total submission, the master, the Lord, forms or transforms the lives of the servants. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10 says, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." In this light, Paul was very proud of himself being a servant of God. All his letters, he always begins like this. I, comma, Paul, comma, a servant of God. Well, if you have King James Version, it says, I, Paul, a slave of Jesus Christ. He was very proud of himself. Yes, I'm a slave of Jesus Christ. I was very proud of myself when I was a master of Taekwondo. And I told you before, I'm a black belt. Do not get me angry. When I was a master, God called me to give up my title being a master, but to serve the master. And I am very, very proud of myself for making a right decision. And I am very proud of myself for serving the master. Here's a question. About what are we pride or proud of ourselves? Are we proud of ourselves because we have a nice home? Or we have a good retirement? Or are we proud of paying taxes on time? Are we proud of what we as a servant or slave of God, have we ever been proud of ourselves because of our obedience to God? Because our willingness to follow guidance of the Holy Spirit? Are we proud of ourselves as a faithful servant of God. Are we willing to obey our Master and His will more and more as we are in this spiritual journey? God is the God of the universe. In Him we live, we move, we breathe, and we have our beings. Therefore, Jesus wants us to know that all we have belong to God. It is a wisdom to know that all we have come from God, goes back to God, and belongs to God. Yes, we definitely pay our taxes. Taxes are the part of our possessions. But we give all to God. We take one slice of pizza, which is our possessions, and pay for our taxes. But what Jesus says in today's scripture, God claims the whole pizza, our whole being, who we are, and all that we have. When we do it, it is guaranteed by God that we have a much happier life. It is ironic that when we give ourselves to God, we think we could not have anything, but we are full and we have all. Martin Luther said, "I have held many things in my hand, and I have lost them all. But whatever I have placed in God's hand, that I still possess." In today's scripture, Jesus does not divide the world into two equal realms, clearly defining the boundaries between our obligation to Caesar and our obligation to God. Rather, his answer acknowledges our obligation to the state, but affirms the largest and greatest obligations to God. Coin bearing Caesar's image may belong to Caesar, but all things, coins, Caesar, Rome, America, and the universe, even our heart and mind, come from the mind of God and are under God's dominion. Caesar's realm is but a speck within God's realm. Caesar is like a speck of dust, but God is God, the creator of the universe. The days of Caesar's realm is numbered, but God's realm is eternal. The territory of Caesar is limited, but God is omnipresent. Caesar is not our God, but the Lord is our God. We do not belong to Caesar, but we belong to God. When we are living, is in Christ Jesus. When we are dying, is in the Lord. Both in our living and in our dying, we belong to God. We belong to God. Some of us watch the presidential debate or gubernatorial debate, or we watched both of them. Lots of efforts, energy, strategy, time, resources has been used by candidates from both sides. It is important to choose the right person for our president, our government, and other government positions. lots of people expressed their differing opinions and feelings about the candidates. Some of us have already voted to express what we believe. We spend lots of time and energy on this issue because they will be our future. Their political beliefs and our votes determine our taxes, and we are to pay our taxes to Caesar. However, the more important fact for us is to know who we are. We are children of God. Whose we are? We belong to God. By confirming our identity, we know what kind of obligation we have before God and how we dedicate our lives to Christ. Listen, we will not be wise Christian if we use tremendous energy efforts for the discussion and the argument about the candidates, and to impose our political beliefs and the political party on others. That's not wise things as a Christian. But here is a wise way of living Christian life. First of all, we pray for the nation. Pray for the nation. And pray for the candidates on both sides. And also, when time comes, we go to vote. Pray and vote. Three, whenever or whatever decisions will be made in the future, we support the decision. Because, again, the Bible says, God has appointed higher authorities. It's not about the Democrats. It's not about Republicans. It is about God. Before we were born in America, long before we spoke a word, mama, before we chose our political party, before we become partisans of our party, even before we pay taxes to the emperors, God chose you and me from the foundation of the world to be God's precious children. Before we knew God, God loves us already. Before we spoke the word Papa, God has given us eternity through His Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Our loyalty is in God. We have a double citizenship. America and heaven. While we are living in America, we perform our duties and the responsibilities. But remember, our ultimate citizenship is in heaven. We have been faithful in paying taxes to Caesar. We have been faithful. Shouldn't we have more faithfulness to God and exalt the name of God in our lives? Jesus does not want us to have a divided loyalty by putting our Caesar and God half and half, but to give all our loyalty to God. From moving loyalty divided to loyalty united has a things to do with the giving of ourselves. giving ourselves totally to God and giving ourselves in an appropriate way to others. That's what Jesus wants us to do in today's lesson. And these are the great command and the greatest our obligations to God. So my beloved brothers and sisters, can we be faithful to God in this time as we are going to have an election? Be faithful to God unto death, and that you will receive the crown of life. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us pray. O God, grant that what we have been heard and said with our lips and with our ears, we may believe in our hearts, and that what we believe in our hearts, we may practice in our lives, so that we may live a holy and glorify you in all things that we do and say. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. The word of God has been proclaimed. Now it is our turn to respond what we will do with the word. In that, we offer ourselves and our offerings to God. So let us pray. We have rendered to Caesar much that we do not care to give, O God. Now we return to you the gifts that are yours. All our wealth and possessions belong to you. Bless our use of these resources, both what we bring for the church's ministry and outreach, and we have keep to support ourselves and provide for those we love most. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. As we continue to worship our living and loving God, let us share our celebrations and prayer requests with one another. But first of all, Jim, who are the good-looking young men beside you and look like his wife? Who are they? Would you be kind to share with us?
This is our son Chris and Melanie Lawson.
Yes. Well, we are very glad to have you today.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Ellen said that his grandmother is all the way back there, so we're glad to have you. Yes. Well, also we thank God for annual charity conference was finished last Thursday, and also we have a new secretary, Taran. Would you stand so that everybody recognizes you and her husband Sean with the two children? Let's welcome them. And Valerie and Joseph are their children. We are glad to have you. And also we have Naira Hayer's daughter, Kathy Haycock, is in Pinehurst Hospital. She has had a heart attack, and a stent was put in last night. So remember her in your prayers. Today, Susie Horsfeld could not be with us. She is under the weather, so remember her in your prayers. Yesterday, we had a community hiking band. We had seven adults and five children. We thoroughly enjoyed the hiking in Uhari. We try to have this hiking once a month, so if you are willing to join us, that would be great. I try to put the people community together so everybody can love and share love of Christ with one another. that side, I'd like to invite Brother James Borges. He will come and speak a few words. Please come.
Safety will be our priority. Students and their parents will have to sign in for contact tracing if necessary, have their temperature checked, and 100.4 or higher, and they will not be admitted into the building. And either have their own face mask or we'll provide them with one. There will be COVID-19 safety signings at the entrance, as well as touchless sanitation stations and at the entrance and the classrooms. Work areas will be socially distanced and cleaned and sanitized after each use. Each area will have tables, chairs, desk shields, and headphones. There will be sanitation stations, bathroom facilities, and snacks and bottled waters. There will also be a full-time coordinator and volunteers to help the students. We're planning on having about 20 workstations available on a first-come basis, and we'll work with anyone and do our best to accommodate your needs. We're excited about the positive feedback and the enormous support that we have already received, and I know that some of y'all out there have already helped with this project as well. So where do y'all come in at? Two ways. One, help us get the word out. The second way, I'm sure there's probably some teachers, or retired teachers, or maybe you know someone. Come up and volunteer. We would really appreciate that. You know, at the end of the day, it's all about the children. And this is a great way to keep our students from falling further behind. And I'm going to have there's some flyers back here on one of the benches. Basically what I've just read to you. But it also has my name and number. If, you know, I'm sure all of y'all have internet service, but maybe you know a family that doesn't, or they're not, where they're going for their hotspot isn't working for them. We're gonna have very safe conditions under which they can come into a classroom setting, but it's still not, you know, be the school. So any help, especially with volunteering, that you could provide would be greatly appreciated. And I want to thank Pastor Khan again, and I appreciate your time for listening.
One of the best theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he says, church does not only exist for the people inside, but also church exists for the people in the community. So if you are willing to help our people, please contact Brother James. We have a good celebration. That is our lovely sister, Sarah Jordan, is much better at the hospital. I talked with her at the hospital. She's getting there. And also our sister, Sandra, she came out from the hospital and she moved into one of her son's house in Charlotte, Justin's home, and she is going to commute from home to hospital from now on until she will have a full recovery. So continue to pray for her. And continue to remember Chris Baxley, Bobby Dean, Jimmy Riddings, Nancy Robinson, Dan Jones, Steve Schiffer, and Mark Haywood and Laura Haywood. Are there any prayer requests or a celebration that you want to share with the authors? If not, let us pray. Holy righteous God, we live in a nation that speaks your name, but too often ignores your will. We are eager to claim your blessing, even of deeds you will not bless. Help us to be wise and discerning, understanding that not all we say, Lord, Lord, will enter into the kingdom of heaven, or even understand the nature of that kingdom. We are in a time when political debate is heated, with the elections only days away. Help us to remember that government is ordained by you and should be operated in such a way that you will be honored. But remind us often that human government and your kingdom are not the same thing. Help us to be ever mindful that our first loyalty is not to the things of Caesar, but to the things of your kingdom. Make us good citizens, but even more, make us faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. We pray all these in your Son's name, Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples how to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Our closing hymn is Take My Life and Let It Be. God created us with his image. So we give our lives, our hands, and our feet, our will, all everything to God. So please stand and join me. Take my life.
Oh, flow within us as a river of life. May we drink deep of her wisdom. May we never thirst again. May we go through life refreshing many as a sign of a healing for all, through the one who is of eternal life. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, the people of God say,
Amen.